please give a warm welcome to entrepreneur, investor, programmer, and author of the best-selling book, The Differences That Make a Difference, Pedro David Espinoza.
Gracias. Buenos días. How's everyone doing? ¿Cómo están todos? ¿Hablamos español? ¿O portugués? ¿Un poco portugués? ¿Fal portugués? Okay, perfect. We'll stick to English and Spanish. Building bridges and the U advantage. Who here knows what it means to build a bridge? What it means to build a community, a relationship, a personal board of advisors, a personal board of directors? Who here is a brave person who wants to define what does it mean to build a bridge? I want to volunteer. Raise your hand. It means to connect. Wonderful. Thank you. Round of applause for our brave volunteer. I'll sign your book later. So in this presentation of building bridges and having the youth advantage, we're going to talk about the power of building a community and reaching out to mentors, sponsors, advisors, and going through challenges in order to give and serve others. During high school, I had the great opportunity of not only being in the tennis team and serving in the Music Honor Society and having a great GPA, but something was missing. There was a lack of identity, a lack of purpose, a lack of meaning. I knew that I had to study hard, get good ACT, study for the TOEFL, because I grew up in Peru, and my first language wasn't English. Who here has Spanish as their mother tongue? Okay, that's more than 90%, so we can relate to each other. And in high school, I was training for tennis, studying for the TOEFL, for the SAT, playing tennis, and it was really hard to find purpose in my life. And at the same time, when I was 14, my mom, Julia, started a nonprofit called Pan Peru. The mission of Pan Peru was to empower the youth and empower the women and build libraries in remote areas of Peru where there is no access to tap water, no access to reliable electricity, no Wi-Fi, no books, no library, nothing. And when I was 14, I was very, very, very immature. And I asked her, Mami, ¿por qué estás invirtiendo tanto tiempo, tanto sudor, tantas ganas en ayudar a los niños de Pampas Grande que están lejos? ¿Y por qué no usas eso para comprarme una guitarra? And my mom gave me that look. And I said, uh-oh, I'm in trouble. That's the look that my Latina mom said, I'm gonna challenge you. Rather than focusing on yourself and asking for a new guitar or a drum set, go to Pampas Grande, 12,000 feet above sea level in the Sierras, volunteer building this library, volunteer meeting these kids, and let me know if you think it is better to give than to receive. And let me know if it's actually worth it to give your time to others and build bridges for them to succeed. 14-year-old me, being type A, hyperactive, energetic, I took the challenge. So I got on a bus for more than 11 hours. It was very cold in the Andes of Peru. Finally got there after having soroche, which is altitude sickness, for those of who you don't know, and we got to Pampas Grande. Volunteering with these kids, and even before starting to build the library or meeting with the other nonprofit volunteers, I was already in high school, so I asked these children, what do you want to do when you grow up? Where are you planning for college? What do you want to major in? And all of them said, there's no single college or university or community college within an 100-mile radius. And our future is staying in agricultura, staying in la cocina, staying con la familia, without studying, without education. And the response of these two young students in Pampas Grande, Diego y Juana, really touched my heart. Because I had the blessing of going to the American School of Lima, bilingual education, international school, and meeting these young, beautiful, loving children that had so many talents, were very gifted interpersonally, very charismatic, but no access to a computer, no access to a library, really struck my heart. After volunteering with this Pamperu nonprofit and realizing that it is better to give than to receive, and helping the other volunteers and building the little computer lab, building the greenhouse next to the library and multimedia center, I came back to my high school in Lima, and I started a small club called Yatai. Yatai in Quechua means to play. And as a musician, I loved playing the guitar, playing the drums. And so with this small club in high school, we started to build fundraisers. We started to do benefit concerts. And we would give the proceeds to buy instruments and buy little computers and laptops and books to the kids in Pampas Grande. Little by little, week by week, day by day, we were doing these events, these fundraising events, and expanding that awareness to the international students at the American school that there is hope, and we can bring hope to these kids in the mountains of Peru. It was extremely hard because we were competing with the other high school clubs that were much more hip than ours. They were helping kids in Lima, which is the capital, it's only 20 minutes away, to go to the slums, or El Pueblo Joven in Lima. And we tried to attract volunteers to go all the way to Pampas Grande, right? 14 hours away on a huge bus, no AC, no heating system. We had a disadvantage. But hustling, persevering, talking to my teachers, I remember there was one teacher. His name was Professor Hector Acuña. And I told him this story. I said, you know, I went to the mountains in Pampas Grande, and I saw these children, and I really want to help and change their life. I want to fundraise. I want to raise awareness for this cause. And he shared me his story, that his family was also from the mountains, and that his family, he was the first in his family to attend college. And not only that, he got his master's from University of Chicago. And he was very proud to have those humble roots from the mountains and coming all the way from Los Andes de Peru to University of Chicago for a master's in mathematics. For those of you who are from Chicago. Anyone from Chicago? Woo! So we connected with Professor Hector Acuña High School at the American School of Lima. He then vouched for me. He introduced me, made a wonderful email introduction to the principal, Chris Aiken, at my high school 6 years ago. He said, Principal Chris, Pedro is a student, his family is from the mountains, and they want to start a high school club, but they need sponsorship from leadership at the school to do an official sponsored trip from Lima to Pampas Grande in the mountains, so they can help build more libraries and help staffing more computer labs and multimedia educational centers. This was a crazy idea, because the American School of Lima, for some that don't know, sponsored by the US Embassy, is very safe, very secure, AC, they have a bunch of resources because the US Embassy is very generous with their American schools. And sending these kids that were from a very different perspective, very different circle, to Pampas Grande was closing those gaps and building those relationships from being in the mountains with sin electricidad o sin agua bebible, and meeting these high schoolers that were very diverse. In my high school, 40% of the students were not from Peru. Americans, Canadians, Europeans, Asians, whatnot. And so that trip expanded horizons bilaterally. And in the span of 4 years, when I was already a senior in high school, that same little boy, Diego, and that same little girl, Juana, came back to me when I was volunteering at Pampas. And they knocked on the door when I arrived the first day. And they said, Pedro, I know what I want to study now. I know who I aspire to be. I know what I want to do when I grow up. They were already 16 by now. And I said, really, what do you want to be? They said, quiero ser una ingeniera. Quiero construir puentes. Quiero construir un highway, una pista, que conecta mi pueblo con la capital del departamento de Huaraz. To help improve lives in my community and connect, because Pampas is away from everything, middle of nowhere. And that whole story of these two children having access to a computer in 4 years, learning what civil engineering means, being aware of what entrepreneurship means, really inspired me to push further, to build more bridges, to continue growing, not only as an entrepreneur, but also as a person, and also as a brother, because we're all in this together. And seeing Diego and Juana saying, thanks to you and Pan Peru and the American School of Lima, now we have access to an Apple, a Mac computer, we know what civil engineering is, we want to build bridges, we want to build roads, we want to help our pueblo get out of poverty. I was like, woo, this is really inspiring. I want to build more of those. And all of this story was part of my college application essay to UC Berkeley. Go Bears! Anyone from Berkeley? Woo! And in my scholarships interview at UC Berkeley, at Dwinell Hall, for those who have been to Berkeley, my interviewer said, Pedro, this beautiful story of building bridges and helping underserved communities in your homeland of Peru, you are next to Silicon Valley. California is the innovation capital of the world. You're in the right place to be at the right time. Why don't you start a company? Why don't you start a social venture to repeat this process and help more charities, more nonprofits, more companies create a better impact and give smarter? And as soon as I heard those words, my mind and my brain, I was like, woo, this is a massive, great idea. But then again, I was a freshman from Peru, not from the US, international. I had no community, no network, no mentors, no advisors in the Bay Area, California, as an 18-year-old. I was like, this is a great idea, right? But how do I get there? I don't have investors, I don't have co-founders, I don't have teammates. So I started executing a plan and an exercise, which we're going to do in a couple of minutes, because you have the book in your tables. And I started strategizing. Okay, I need to meet some engineers to build a website. I started attending and auditing some computer science classes. I started meeting people in the things that I'm passionate about, because that's the you advantage, is building bridges genuinely is who you are. And I love sports. So I decided to play some tennis, go jogging. There's a bunch of clubs in college. And there, I met people who were computer science majors. And I told them this idea, hey, I'm from Peru, my mom, my dad, they're from Pampas Grande. We really wanna build a website to help not only Pan Peru 501c3 nonprofit, but any nonprofit, any 501c3 in the world to make an impact. And that's what eventually happened. I met up with my co-founder CTO, Joey Pereira, and we started building a website called SmileyGo.com. SmileyGo because I believe in the power of joy and the power of being grateful and positive through trials and tribulations. And go because of go-getters, because you are future changemakers, and we need to push forward. We need to unite and be one body, one community, one family, and thrive and go. And with our team at SmileyGo, we were able not only to help PAN Perú receive funding and help from Western Union Foundation in Colorado. Anyone from Colorado? Two people. Cool. Welcome. We were able to help the Dropbox Foundation and many other nonprofits that were supported by our corporate users in our software as a service. So this is how we connected all the dots of me being an immature 14-year-old complaining to my mom, why are you investing so much time, money, and sweat helping these kids in the Highlands, and why don't you buy me more instruments, to really advocating and seeing how powerful it is to give, how powerful it is to build bridges and think of others as more important than yourselves. So this story of entrepreneurship and building that personal board of advisors ends with this picture in Pampas Grande with my parents and the PAN Perú team, where we successfully built two new greenhouses where the local children and women of Pampas Grande were managers of the greenhouse, and they were entrepreneurs. They were producing organic lettuce, organic carrots, organic radish, and we were empowering them to build those bridges and build those ventures. At the end of college in 2017, I was very blessed to have a community of people that supported me, of people that believed in SmileyGo and my social ventures and my passion for entrepreneurship and building ventures. This is a picture of our team at SmileyGo in 2017, where we were building the software to help nonprofits get more funding, help nonprofits get volunteers from corporate America, like our wonderful sponsors, Wells Fargo, BP, Marriott International, Toyota, and so forth. Now, I want everyone to join me in this activity. There is note cards and pens in each of the tables, and you have a book, Differences That Make a Difference. Please feel free to share and build those connections and those bridges today. And on the note card, I would like for you to join me in drawing three circles. So take your time and share pens if needed. If you need a pen, please raise your hand. Happy to help. Okay, everyone's good. Okay, so please draw three circles on the note cards and label each circle. The first one, operational. The second one, personal. And the third one, strategic. And think for the next couple of minutes, people that you genuinely trust, familia, mentores, personas que creen en ti. For operational, put 3 to 5 people that help you on the day-to-day business. So if you're a student, what I did not too long ago was I would put the professors I had really good relationships with, that I would play tennis with. And I'll share you a story in a couple minutes. I would put my classmates. I would put my church friends. I would put my club friends from club soccer or IMs, intramurals tennis. If you're a business executive, this is your day-to-day business, right? If you're a small company, you're COO, or you know who you do business with every day. If you're a Fortune 500 company, it could be your team, your business unit, your direct reports, your colleagues, your coworkers, or your supervisor. So put 3 to 5 people. On the second circle, personal, these are people and friends that you can really trust, and they help you grow on a personal, family, spiritual, individual level, relationship-wise. People that you immediately know who to call when you're having trouble with your boyfriend or girlfriend or significant other, or when you failed a class or an exam, which I have, and we're all in this together. Berkeley was hard. So on the personal, put those people on the day-to-day that you genuinely trust and you know beyond business, beyond professional networking. And on the third circle, strategic. This is future-oriented. Strategic is people that will help you shape your career, where you aspire to be, who you admire, who you respect. Could be a role model. Could be a mentor. So take a few minutes and thinking, these are key people in your life today that have helped you be where you are. Could be family members. And as you're thinking, I'll share a story. For me, strategic is Pat Gelsinger. He is the CEO of VMware, is a multi-billion dollar company in Silicon Valley. He went to Stanford in Santa Clara. And he's a role model of mine. Every now and then we periodically meet, and he gives me really good advice in terms of where should I go for graduate school, for jobs, for speaking gigs, for negotiation classes. And he helped me do a personal statement. And one of my goals for the next 3 years is to learn Mandarin Chinese, and I have a friend every week who's teaching me Chinese. So these are the kind of things that a strategic mentor, a strategic person in your circle, will shape you and encourage you and advise you. Another example on the personal, John Knox for me. He's my housemate. I live in San Mateo, for those of you in the Bay Area. And we see each other every day, but we also share, and we're vulnerable with one another. When a business opportunity doesn't go well, when a class I took at UC Berkeley 2 years ago didn't go well. And then on the operational circle, for me, was Giacomo. He's a software engineer. He's also from Peru. But when I was taking a JavaScript class last summer, he was helping me every day, every week, with for loops and arrays and strings and everything. So I would really trust him on a business day-to-day learning experience. So now that you have drawn your three circles, I would like for you to identify critical connections in those circles. So one or two people that you genuinely really trust who has remarkably helped you in your career, in your education today. And put a star next to it. Frank Baxter, for me, on the strategic, was more than a role model. Frank Baxter was the U.S. ambassador to Uruguay under President Bush administration. And he was also the CEO of Jefferies, a financial investment company headquartered in New York, but it's a multinational company. I saw him a few days ago. But Frank Baxter was the first investor at Smiley Go. When I was a 19-year-old entrepreneur from Peru, didn't know anyone, I went to Crossroads Dining Hall, for those of you who know UC Berkeley campus, and I see a senior, he's 82 years old, I see a senior man dressed up in a nice suit and tie eating at a college dining hall. And I followed my mom's advice. Júntate con los mejores. Siéntate al lado del mejor. En la clase, siéntate en la primera fila. So I saw Mr. Frank Baxter. I had no clue who he was. He seemed important. So I literally just went and sat next to him. And I said, hi, my name is Pedro. And he had a US flag and a Uruguayan flag. So I said, oh, I'm from South America too. And he said, yeah, I lived in Uruguay for 7 years and I speak Spanish. So we connected. We had that in common. Even though I thought I had nothing in common with an 80-year-old senior executive leader, you will find things in common when you jump outside of your comfort zone. And I will confess, it was strange for me in the beginning. I was a bit scared and afraid. I was like, what is he gonna say? I'm a freshman in college, I'm 19. He's probably a very important man. And he was. He was a board member, trustee of the University of California Foundation. And he said that the restaurant he had an appointment with for some reason closed that day. So he ended up eating lunch at Crossroads Dining Hall at UC Berkeley. Such a coincidence. And then we connected and he loved Peru. He's been to Peru. And I told him about my Smiley Go idea. And he was the first investor, the first person to write a check for my little startup company in San Francisco. So this is what I mean when critical connections, right? People that really vouch for you, people that is a role model and you aspire to be like her or him one day, and who really support you. The most important concept in building bridges and having the you advantage of being genuinely yourself is following up. It takes a lot of time, effort, to build a relationship, to build a bridge, to have a mentor, to have a coworker, role model. But if you don't follow up, and if you don't send happy 4th of July cards, or Merry Christmas, or happy birthday, happy anniversary, then eventually, if you don't follow up and persist, that relationship dies. So my advice, and what I love to do when it's their birthday, or anniversary, or anything important in their life, I love sending a short and sweet text or an actual postcard if I'm in Miami or traveling for business or in San Diego. And I send them these things so they remember me. Because people love people that remember them and know about them. So here's an example of Jimmy He. He's one of my best friends from Stanford. I did a management science engineering program at Stanford for those of you who are related or affiliated with Stanford. And Jimmy was a medical student there. So I put medical student, I love studying people, right? I put, he's from a Chinese family, born in Australia, he's now studying at WashU in St. Louis. And having this ability of studying people and putting things that they genuinely like and enjoy is good. Because then, if I'm in St. Louis, or if I meet a professor at the med school at Stanford or UCSF, I can put them in touch. And that's the beauty of being a social broker, is connecting the dots from the different circles, right? And I put his address and his birthday, and just a simple text to these people that you admire and you love and you wanna connect will make the difference of following up. And I'll give you another example. The picture on the right, his name is Jack Fuchs. He's a Stanford professor at the engineering school. In 2014, in the summer, I was a summer student at Stanford. I was working on SmileyGo, so I was full-time on my startup, 100 hours a week, slept 4 hours every day. Didn't really obey my mom in that sense. And I enroll in this class, Management Science and Engineering, by Professor Jack Fuchs. I only attend the first class. And I remember that he gave his email and the syllabus. So I reached out to him and I said, I really love entrepreneurship and engineering and tech. I don't really know how to code. I would love to learn. If you have any advice, would love to meet office hours. No response. 1 week later, no response. Emailed him again, no response. Then I looked at Stanford Who Is Who, got his phone number, office number. I called him, left voicemail, nothing. I had to persist more than 4 times in 2 weeks to get an office hour with him. Finally, we sit. I gained his advice. He told me to take a class in San Francisco at Code Academy. And he told me that he loved tennis. And he had tennis balls in his office. And I was like, huh, I love sports. Why don't we play tennis? And he's type A, hyperactive like me. So he said, I take the challenge. If I beat you, you'll buy me lunch. So we started playing tennis at the Stanford tennis courts every month, periodically. And then we started becoming friends. It was no longer a professor-student relationship, but it was more of a bilateral, mutual relationship. We even started sharing the same Gatorade bottle because he trusted me. And we became really, really good friends. And then I moved to San Mateo, and he lived in San Mateo, and he started picking me up to take me to the tennis court to play tennis with him and then dropping me off at my house. So as I'm telling you, this didn't happen in 3 días. This happened in años, right? To build a relationship, it takes time, it takes trust, it takes effort. So in those years, I sent him happy birthday cards. I met his kid eventually. He has 2 kids. His wife. I went to the Christmas, December holiday season family banquet. So it takes time, right? And that's the beauty of following up and adding value to your connections. By adding value, I mean not everything is give, 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 or receive, receive, receive. And with Jack, he was already very generous with me. 1 year, he said, my son is 18-year-old. He loves coding. He's graduating from high school in Palo Alto. He wants an internship at a video game company because he loves gaming. You're young as well. Do you know anyone in that industry? And I said, absolutely. Even though my mom threw away my PlayStation when I was 10, I still have friends that play, and I still have friends in San Mateo and San Francisco that are running video game companies. So I made that meaningful connection with Zach Fuchs, his son. And Jack was so grateful and so thankful for that. And I'm sharing this example because I've met so many kids and college students that really ask me, but how do you add value? Like, why would an 18-year-old immigrant like add value to an investor or a venture capitalist or a Stanford professor? But you can, just being you, being genuine, like sharing what you like and not being afraid of opening up and being yourself. And as getting to know Jack Fuchs and his family, I found out that he's not only a Stanford professor and lecturer, but he's also a venture capitalist, he's an angel investor, and he has several Teslas, which is pretty cool. He let me drive his Tesla too. And that's what I'm saying, right? Like building these bridges and strengthening them is the most important thing. Because if you don't strengthen and follow up, people are very busy in the US and in the world, and they're probably not gonna get back to you. So having that initiative and being proactive. And in the middle picture, you can see Giacomo and his family. I was talking about Giacomo, software engineer at Apple. I was invited to speak at a technology entrepreneurship conference in Peru 2 years ago. I met Giacomo's dad, who was the panelist moderator for a speech that we were giving. And at the time, I was 22. Yes, I'm 24 now. And he was telling me, I have a son who's 19. He just moved to Silicon Valley. I would love for you to just sit with him for 30 minutes. I'll pay you lunch. You can go eat Peruvian buffet, chicha morada, lomo saltado, ají, de gallina, ceviche, and just talk. He needs an older brother. And I was like, I'm down. I love Peruvian food. So we go to this really cool restaurant called La Mar in San Francisco. For those who have been, it's pretty good. And I meet Giacomo, 19-year-old. He's like, yeah, I love coding, and I'm going to this 42 school in Newark in the East Bay, which is a really cool coding school. I recommend it for all of you. He said, we are learning project-based learning. And I said, huh, what about professors or mentors or advisors? He says, no, I just moved here. I don't have mentors. It's been kind of awkward. I reached out to someone. Do you want to be my mentor? And he looked back at me. What do you mean? So then we started playing ping pong and soccer. He's a really good football player. And I shared the little that I knew to him. And we became really good friends. 2 years later, Giacomo Giulfo is now a software engineer at Apple in Cupertino. He is a green card. He got his green card, which is a blessing. And we're still good friends. And he's teaching me like JavaScript and Ruby on Rails. And it's a bilateral relationship. As I said, never underestimate anyone. Like, people can share what they know. Everyone has a unique story. And with Giacomo, he was so thankful that I met up with him and shared my struggles as well, that every now and then when I publish a book for Pan Peru, the nonprofit of my mom, he's the first one buying like 10 copies and sharing it with all his family. When I launch my book, Differences That Make a Difference, he's the first one to like share it with his company and team at Apple. And he's giving back. And that's the thing, right? Building this tribe, these people that believe in you, that give back and push it forward. This picture here is from summer of 2017, our Smiley Go team. I've never heard of anyone be successful at a startup doing it part-time. We weren't part-time, however, we volunteered every Friday of the summer at different charities we believed in their mission, paying it forward, giving back. And this builds a culture of belonging, builds a culture of inclusion, a culture of generosity, which has been proven to have better financial returns in companies and Fortune 500 companies as well. Having diverse teams is much more important and brings more creativity and innovation. To give you one statistic, last year, 44% of the Fortune 500 companies were started by immigrantes or their kids. Yes, immigrantes. This was 3 years ago at the San Jose City Hall. And if you see, the future is Hispanic. In Silicon Valley, if you go to a kindergarten class, over 50% come from Latino families. So future changemakers, you are today changemakers. You can start changing the world today. You can start asking the person at your table, how can I help you? ¿Cómo te puedo servir? How can I be a social broker for you? How can I play tennis with you or soccer or cook with you? Whatever you like to do, be yourself and share and open up. People love people that open up. And in this conference, these Latino students, they were 12, 13, 15, 16, they were all asking, how do I start learning about entrepreneurship? How do I go into STEM? How do I start a company? Do I have to get a degree? Do I have to take a class? And the reality is, you don't need a title to be a leader. The reality is, you can start leading, you can start creating today. You can start building those bridges of relationships today. And as I was saying in the past, it's about serving and giving others, right? So if serving is beneath you, leadership is beyond you. What our other sponsorship speaker remarked. It's about going outside of your comfort zone, mentoring others, connecting with others, and really giving advice and also adding value bilaterally. So today, I'm challenging you, every one of you, what bridge are you building today? Are you building a bridge of love, a bridge of friendship, a bridge of hate, a bridge of fear? I challenge you today to meet someone, shake their hand, share your email, contact info, and genuinely ask them, how can I serve you? Because many times in the circle exercise, many of us, if not all of us, are in the strategic circle of another person. You today can be a role model for another person. In the same way as we have leaders and people we admire, we want to be like in 5, 10, 15, 20 years, you today are the role model para una persona ahora. Entonces, el tiempo de servir y ayudar es ahora. I challenge you to build your tribe, your community, today. This picture exemplifies what I love doing. Time is my love language. I love spending time with my friends or business partners or everything. And here with our church community, we're just having a potluck and cooking jambalaya. Peruvian food, Chinese food, Thai food, diversity is good. And that's what my book is about. And this is what I want to end, because every single one of you, you have a book copy. I met Jorge Titinger, Jorge es peruano también, arriba Perú, at Stanford 3 years ago. At the time, Jorge was the CEO of Silicon Graphics International. It was a public company at the time, multi-million dollar tech company. And I really respected and admired him. I was like, wow, Jorge, you're my dad's age, you went to Stanford, you got your MBA, your master's in engineering. I really want to be like you. So we started playing golf, we started hanging out, playing soccer. I cooked for him one day, he was very impressed. And we can cook later, yes. And then, after spending more quality time together, I told him, Jorge, I really care about diversity and inclusion. My mom, who's sitting right there, so a round of applause for her, Julia. And my dad, who's a... Yo le dije a Jorge, my mom is an engineer. Es una ingeniera. Mi papá es ingeniero. We're all immigrants. We're from Peru. Mi hermana es doctora. My sister Karina is doctor in Orange County. My other sister is a businesswoman. I really care about empowering underserved people. I really care about diversity. I want to make a difference. I'm tired of all these big companies saying they care about diversity, but then when you look at the number of dollars that they invest every fiscal year, it's very low. That's the truth. And that was the truth to some companies, unfortunately. So I told Jorge, and Jorge said, why don't we join forces and write a book to make not only the business case for inclusion, which many of us already know, but also interview and get these anecdotes from top leaders like Reed Hastings from Netflix, Eric Schmidt from Google, Jonathan Rosenberg from Alphabet, Dan Schulman from PayPal, and 170 other executives that are part of the majority of these sponsor companies. So with Jorge, for the last year, I sat down, did phone interviews and one-on-one interviews, 30-minute, an hour, 10-minute interviews, with the CEOs of PayPal, Google, and so forth. And that was really inspiring for me because growing up in Peru, I never thought I was going to meet Eric Schmidt, who was the chairman of Alphabet and the CEO of Google. I never thought I was going to meet all these top CEOs to interview them for my book on the power of hiring diverse people, on the power of retaining talent, on the power of investing in the future. Because yes, the future of America is diverse. The future of America is Hispanic. We are all in this together. So with Jorge, I was very blessed to join forces and interviewing these executives and gaining their anecdotes. Because people remember stories, like the story of Juana y Diego, que querían ser ingenieros. People don't really remember statistics. Everyone knows the facts. People remember tu historia. So gaining these stories from Reed Hastings, from Dan Schulman, and all these CEOs and Fortune 500 companies, we were able to produce this book that has tangible steps for entrepreneurs like you, Changemakers, and executives like you, BP, Marriott International, Toyota, and so forth, to be an ambassador for inclusion. Not only to have a diverse company, which diversity already happens today, there's no two people that are the same, we are all different. Inclusion is inviting them and asking them to dance, right? Diversity is inviting people to a party. Inclusion is asking them to dance. So I encourage every one of you to think, how can you build bridges today by being yourself and having that diversity advantage, making the case that you are the future and that you can make a change by being a social broker and connecting the circles and the dots and the super connectors. To go back on Jorge, we got introduced by Mayor Ron Gonzalez. He was the former mayor of San Jose, the first Hispanic mayor in the city of San Jose since 1850. Ron Gonzalez was sitting on my board at Smiley Go. When I was 19, I asked him to sit on my board. I got introduced to him thanks to Carl Guardino, who was the CEO of Silicon Valley Leadership Group, who's a good friend of mine and role model. As you can see, it's all about relationships. It's all about making connections, relating to people. Once you have a solid, trustworthy relationship with someone and he or she vouches for you, you are able to make more meaningful connections and to thrive. And that's how I was grateful to connect with Jorge and many other leaders, Latinas y Latinos, to make a difference in this world. So keep making that difference. Keep building those bridges. Keep looking at your circles of trust and being a social broker in order to push it forward and give back always. I will be here at the entire convention center. We are signing books at the Family Latino Expo hoy día y mañana, and we're giving autographed copies as well. So don't be shy. I love people. And here's my contact information in this last slide. Feel free to email or reach out with any questions. If you text that keyword to that number, you'll get a special treat. And if you show it to me, I'll share the surprise. And yeah, thank you so much. Keep building those bridges and let's push it forward. Muchísimas gracias.